Hello, everyone. Welcome to GT Time. I'm your moderator, Kyle Bossman, and joining us, as always, is our uniquely talented and knowledgeable panel, including in the Brandon Jones seat, Matt Blair.
I'm not Brandon Jones.
I almost said it. It just goes, it flows so easily. And Daniel Bloodworth in his own seat. In the super seat this week, Bradley Ellis.
Hello.
And making this all happen, Mr. Ian Hink.
Hi.
There we go. Hi, everybody.
There's my lower.
Nice.
Hang on, we're looking at my lower.
What okay. If I'm listening, though?
Then
too bad.
Whatever, you made your choice.
I would prefer, I think the way that I would prefer to watch the show is to listen to it.
Oh, absolutely. There's no reason to watch this thing.
Yeah. none of us dress up. None of us are looking nice today, yeah. if you were curious. Brad, you in the super seat, we have a new question.
Mm-hmm.
It's summertime.
Okay.
Everyone's on, you know, you're feeling it's time for vacations. It's summertime. Brad, if you could go to anywhere in the world, if you could visit any place, where would you go and why?
I'm going to take the obvious nerd answer.
Okay.
Tokyo, Japan.
Okay. Why?
Maybe not.
Everything
summer.
I love is there. Japanese video games and giant robots. I would spend way too much money there, though, if I went there.
Let's talk about giant robots.
There's Gundams there, like life-size Gundams.
Yeah.
I need to see that before I die.
I would love to see that.
I don't know that they set it up permanently anywhere, though.
Well, I need to find some.
Yeah, well, find one. There's got to be one Gundam, Blood. There's got to be one somewhere. Yeah. Blood, why did you say no Tokyo in the summer?
It's pretty hot, pretty humid.
You power through it.
It's pretty crazy.
Oh, because you've been to Tokyo Game Show.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay, I got you. Brad, when you're going to Tokyo, do you have a person to guide you, or are you just, like, running wild?
I want to run wild, mm-hmm. but it'd be nice to have someone that can't speak Japanese.
You need a guide.
Yeah.
It's a huge city. Huge city.
But I kind of want to, like, explore, and I just end up in some back alley shady deal, as Mike likes to say.
Mm-hmm.
Get some ramen back there. See something sketch go
actually,
down.
Some Yakuza, dude. Yeah.
Some of the best food we had was places that didn't look like would have any food. It was just like a random neighborhood.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, this little place here on this corner. Oh my gosh, this is some of the best food we've ever had in our lives.
Yeah. What is it? What is the best food you've had?
I mean,
in your
it wasn't life? It wasn't like anything that you don't know. It's just they made it better than other people.
Best well, food. Yeah, the best food I had in my life is cheeseburgers.
I mean, like, oh I'm saying God. Corn. Like, amazing corn. I'm like, how did
yeah,
you make
so
corn amazing?
Cheeseburgers?
Yeah.
The best restaurant we found in Tokyo, we just, like, went into a building, and on, like, the sixth floor was this huge restaurant. Everything's vertical there.
Yeah.
Cool.
It's crazy. No one spoke English at all. It was phenomenal.
So did you just wander to the sixth floor?
We, like, there was like a picture of a like some kind of food, and we were just like, okay, and we entered the building and just had to keep going up and up until we actually found it.
That's adventure, man.
It was like a winding staircase.
Yeah, love the adventure.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
All right, well, we gotta get to corrections. Begin correction music, please. It's not inflate gate, it's deflate gate.
You got that wrong?
I got that wrong.
Wow.
I called it inflate gate. It's all the same. It's the same thing.
It's the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Literally.
Heracles is the Greek and original name for Hercules, which is the Roman butchering of the name. The name Heracles means Hera's glory. Zeus named him Heracles to please Hera because he was living proof of Zeus's infidelity with the mortal Alcmene. I think that is so funny. Like, baby, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I cheated on you. Look, I named him after you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
Zeus.
Messed up. That's real
Zeus
messed
don't
up.
Get it. He doesn't get it.
I named him your glory. Zeus, what are you doing?
She's the farthest thing from her glory that could possibly be.
And so this poor half-human, half-god grows up being Hera's glory. That's so cool. Tembo, the badass elephant, is rated E to ages 10 and up.
And that's Sega's mistake.
Yeah.
That was on their website. It says teen.
They probably assumed they were going to be teen, and then it came out from the ESRB. They're like, no, we're fine with the word badass. 10-year-olds can say that.
Yeah.
Of all people, I can tell you how difficult it is to keep the ratings straight and update them on websites. I will tell you that right now.
And
but they don't have as many games to worry about as you do.
Yeah, true. Screw those people.
Yeah, they got like 10.
Yikes.
It's pronounced Lionel Messi.
What?
End corrections music. We have, you know, I love to start the show with a game announcement, and boy, oh boy, do we have a huge game announcement this week. Dragon Quest XI.
I forgot my hat.
I'm happy. Honestly, I'm a little happy
brought
for the hat.
Love the hat.
Getting the hat on those headphones.
Matt Blair has a big poofy slime hat.
It's wonderful. Got it at Tokyo Game Show, actually.
Oh, that's cool. What year is this? What year is this where you all went and had adventures at Tokyo Game Show?
2009?
2 years ago?
10?
I don't remember the last year I was there. I was definitely there in 2008.
You weren't there when we were there.
I wasn't there?
No, Blood.
Okay. So
because once I started going to Gamescom, I started basically opting for that instead of TGS.
Whoa.
Yeah. So, okay. I think it must have been 2 or 3 years ago.
3 or 4.
Must be nice.
Like. No.
Somewhere in that range.
It's been a while. Yeah.
So anyway, Square Enix held a press conference only for Dragon Quest games earlier this week. Shoot, what time were we up? I guess it was 1 a.m.
Yeah, like 1 a.m.
It was 1 a.m. On the Pacific Coast. And so it started just announcing many, many Dragon Quest games for mobile and 3DS. Talking about, you know, Dragon Quest Heroes again. But we already saw the logo coming in. We knew that it leaked. And they actually acknowledged that in the beginning of this presentation, which is entirely in Japanese. We had to just rely on images to really tell what was going on with this thing. Unless we're Daniel Budworth, of course.
Oh.
When you're watching a thing like this.
Random words.
Yeah. Can you, like, kind of gauge what's going on?
Not very much. I mean, yeah, once in a while they'll say an English word or some word I might recognize, but.
Like PlayStation 4.
Right.
Yeah, so what happened was Dragon Quest XI was announced. Consoles were not announced leading into this, and there was a lot of speculation about that. And the consoles for this game are the PlayStation 4 and the 3DS.
As of right now.
Right now,
As of right now, yes. But these were what were announced. It was like almost immediately after the game title was shown, those two consoles announced. We should talk about those two versions of the game. That's very confusing. A PlayStation 4 and a 3DS version of the game. They're very different. They have the same story. The PlayStation 4 version is it looks like Dragon Quest 8. It looks like what you would imagine a dream of a Dragon Quest game.
That's my dream, yes.
Yeah. But also, maybe you have the other dream of a Dragon Quest game. Maybe you're Matt Blair.
Yeah, Matt Blair dream right here.
And then the 3DS version is this weird mix. On the top screen, you have a semi, it looks like Dragon Quest 9, basically, a 3D Dragon Quest game. And on the bottom screen, simultaneously, a 2D traditional Dragon Quest game.
Yeah, but although we've just recently learned that that's not the way it's going to play through the whole game.
Right, that's just like what they demoed, the two things running simultaneously, which if you haven't seen that, definitely watch the video. It's really crazy to watch two versions of the same game run at once.
Can I just say, when they announced the 3DS version,
yeah,
I could feel Matt Blair somehow out there
in
the
mad?
Universe. Just, I felt so much joy just come out.
This is best case scenario for the 3DS version.
I was trying not to make too much noise because the significant other was sleeping at this point. Mm-hmm. And all I was expecting was just Dragon Quest XI is going to be really cool. Had no idea that I was going to see something like that. The 3DS one, I mean.
I love how respectful you are. Hubert talks about how he goes and shakes his girlfriend awake just to, like, look at The Witcher 3. You know, just look at this. Matt Blair, do you want to talk about that? Do you think this is a good way to handle, like, two versions of this game? Should there be two versions of this game?
No. I mean, I'm super glad that there is. When they only announced PS4 and 3DS, that to me immediately felt like, okay, they're going for, like, the two biggest consoles out there. They're going for the most units available again, like they've always done. Again, but when you actually see them in action, I kind of get the feeling like they're trying to, and we've said this before, respect the franchise from beginning to where it is now. And so you have something that is an ode to the NES, SNES days that runs at the same time as something that's like, okay, well, here's where Dragon Quest is now on mobile. So we're putting those two together, and then, you know, we're going to do something cool with it.
Oh, sure. Worth mentioning, it's the 30th anniversary of Dragon Quest.
Yes.
Yeah.
You're right. So it is kind of trying to do that as well. Like, just be like, hey, this has been around for 30 years.
And it's kind of weird, but at the same time, I kind of dig it. The fact that they're both Dragon Quest XI, they're both the same game. So, like, maybe the people that only have a 3DS or the people that only have a PlayStation 4 won't feel left out, like they're missing story. But if you have both, they're different enough that you can buy them both and have a lot of fun. If you know, it just depends on which style of Dragon Quest you like. You have choices in the matter. There's really not a whole lot of stuff out there like that these days.
Yeah. Ni no Kuni is the closest example of something that did that. They had a PS3 version and Nintendo DS version. Same story on both. Though I think the PS3 version had some stuff after the DS's story. What's up, Ian?
I just had a clarification quest.
Okay.
So just so I'm clear, they're completely different games being made by completely different, like, teams?
Studios, yes.
Okay, because whenever I hear, like, it's on the 3DS and the PS4, I'm like, oh, man, the PS4 version is going to be terrible.
Right.
No, yeah, the PS4 version is gorgeous.
Yeah, it's hard to explain that. You're right. Thank you, Ian, for making us explain that. The PS4 version is running on Unreal Engine 4.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another huge crazy thing is just, hey, another Japanese developer says, hey, we're just going to use this.
Embracing it, yeah.
I love that. I love that so much. Just get the games done, basically,
mm-hmm.
With something that works and something that's supported. If you're having issues, they'll help you with those.
Yeah.
And I'm
that's what they need, big
too
time.
Stoked about that.
That company especially.
Yeah. After what,
we can't
like,
wait 10 years anymore for games.
Yeah. Dragon Quest X was an MMO, is an MMO, mm-hmm. is still out, is still playable, is actually coming to PS4, was something that was announced.
And 3DS, right? Didn't they say that too?
It's been on 3DS.
It's already
on
3DS.
Oh, it has.
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
All of this is in Japan, of course, which is why we're a little fuzzy on the details, because
sure,
we don't really think about it every day.
So that team, Orca, or a team that worked on that one, is working on the PS4 version, and the team working on the 3DS version is called Toy Logic. And their credits aren't clear to me. I mean, they did work on Kid Icarus on the 3DS and The Evil Within, but I don't know to what extent, you know.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Interesting.
That's their pedigree. But yeah, the 3DS version looks great, especially for a 3DS game.
Yeah, I was surprised how good that game looked, actually.
Yeah, actually, now that they say that you won't play that way the whole time, it makes the fact that there are random battles in the 2D mode make a lot more sense, because like, well, it's not really random if you see them on the other map.
Yeah.
But if you won't go through the whole game, then...
Apparently, though, you can switch on the fly as well.
Yeah.
It's just at one point you have to dedicate yourself. So maybe it's just honestly too much for the game to run both at the same time.
Hmm.
Well, so Ben and I were discussing this on our little live stream reaction thing, and in his quick research, and I don't know if this was confirmed, maybe you can help me with this, but it sounded like if you use the D-pad to move around, when you see both games on the two screens, when you use the D-pad to move around, you get into like the 2D 8-bit type battles.
Right.
Yeah.
And if you use the little slide pad to move around, then you get into the full-on 3D Dragon Quest IX type battles.
Yeah.
So that to me feels like a big chunk of the game has to be playable in both if they've included that feature.
Right? No, it absolutely is.
Clarification request.
Yeah.
So wait, it's like the Halo redo where you can switch at will between a 3D version and a 2D version?
Yes.
Yes, but though at the beginning of the game, the beginning portion of the game is running both simultaneously on two screens at once.
Just to be like, hey, look what you can do.
Yeah.
Yes, mm-hmm. Exactly.
Man, that's wild.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it is, I mean, definitely recommend watching a video of it because it is really cool to see in action. It's very interesting.
But yeah, I think in a way, I think that probably... You know, the PS4 version is the version they wanted to make, and that, you know, the 3DS is there because that's where more of the market is. It's just a huge built-in market for that in Japan.
I don't know if that's fair, Blood, because, like, if you think about how Dragon Quest was for its first 7 games, you know what I mean? Even when Final Fantasy was going out there and doing such crazy things, Dragon Quest stayed traditional for so long.
Right.
I think some people like making this traditional 3DS game. I think they're into it.
Right, but I'm just saying, like, in terms of, yeah, I think that in terms of the market, though, like, they couldn't go all in on just the PS4 because there's just too much of a 3DS market to ignore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
True. Especially considering the last installment was on a whole bunch of consoles. I know, 10 not available in America, so it's like, oh, that doesn't really exist to us, but it's true. It's on a whole bunch of platforms.
PC even.
PC.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think I do think that, you know, considering like Shuhei tweeted out in English about the game, and I think with PS4 development, it's going to be such a significant chunk that there's probably a good chance that they are going to try to bring it over to the West as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. 3DS one, maybe. I think it depends on when it launches. If this game is in 2016, like they're planning on it, yes.
Yeah.
Do you think they'd hold back the PS4 version to make sure that they can release them both at the same time if they have trouble, or vice versa?
Yes, I think that's
probably
a huge
part
of the plan. Do you think that's a mistake?
No. They'll release them at the same time.
Why do you think they should? Why do you think they should release both at the same time?
Because it's just everything is centralized. It's like that's the event is Dragon Quest XI coming out. That's everyone's gonna have that on their mind. They're not gonna care about you know, which one version or the other, they're just going to get Dragon Quest XI whenever it's available.
I get that. So you're part of it, and then both games benefit from being part of the event. Yeah. That actually makes sense to me. I think Metroid did that with Prime and Fusion, yeah? Both the same yeah. day. That's really crazy. Totally irrelevant. Didn't need to bring it up, but just hopped in my mind.
I liked it.
Hey.
What? You got another quest?
Speaking of totally irrelevant, no. Oh, I was just looking at the logo there.
Yeah.
That... I mean, maybe it's just the, like, blade and it doesn't have the handle on it, but man, that sword is impossible to hold.
Okay, so... yeah. Oh, you mean the T?
The T in the Dragon Quest.
The yeah. T in the Dragon Quest is traditionally
a sword. Yeah, for, but, like, there's no handle.
Yeah. It's been that way for, like, well over a decade, probably two
at
this
point.
Just
cut the heck out of your hand right there.
I'm gonna say it's mostly probably for the iconography. I don't know if it's really meant to be a practical sword.
Yeah, that's bothering me. Maybe it's just like they haven't put the handle on yet, you know?
Look at how thick the blade is, too. That thing's a club. That's not a sword.
Yeah, true.
I have one last question I want to ask you all about this reveal that happened. There was no trailer. There was no, here's like a CG trailer to introduce it. The first time we saw this game, we saw the new protagonist's face.
They rolled in like a 10-second little thing that just gave us the logo, and that's it. So you could say there was a teaser, but yes, no real trailer to speak of.
And so, I mean, the game that we saw, the PS4 build, was far from complete, I would say.
Looked like it, yeah.
There are animations that are missing.
There were no NPCs in the streets during the little city shot.
Actually, there were some really high up in the window.
Those are pixels moving around.
Probably
those aren't
2D
like
elements.
Actual people you can interact with. But there were clearly spots and shops for people you could buy stuff from that they weren't there.
Yeah, there was no battle shown. The enemies wouldn't do anything. And so I want to talk to you if you think that was a good idea. If you think it was maybe too soon to show off an early in development game, or do you think that is the best way to reveal this game, Dragon Quest XI?
Better than a screenshot.
Yeah.
Better than a conceptual prototype screenshot.
Yeah.
Is it, though? Is it better?
Yeah.
Like, because we saw the game in a rough state, is what I mean to say. You know what I mean?
We didn't really feel rough.
Yeah.
There's just stuff that's not in there.
Here's the look and feel, and, you know, we're not giving you an announce date. We're just saying, we're working on this game. Here's what it's going to look like. I don't see anything wrong with that.
I would say when he climbed the rope. I'm gonna say like when the character was walking up to the rope, and there was no like animation for that, and he just kind of like walked on an invisible surface on top of the rope as if he was just running on the
floor. That's probably what it's gonna be when it comes out too.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
I mean, the finer details there are not gonna be as important as them balancing all of the gameplay, you know, mechanics and things like that. That's never been a Dragon Quest thing, like Uncharted, sure, but we're not talking about that.
Yeah. Right now. At least it wasn't a CG trailer. We got actual gameplay. For like a lot of gameplay too.
So, well, no, you didn't. You got a person walking around.
That was like 10 minutes though. But we got to see him walking around. Actually, he was playing the game. You saw him holding the controller, which is actually cool.
Right. That is worth noting is that we saw like live gameplay with someone holding a controller for the debut of the game. The first time anyone saw this game.
The man behind it for a lot of years now.
Yuji Horii. Got it. Live corrections.
They'll probably show more soon, too. That Jump Fiesta, is that what it's called? Festa?
Jump Festa?
Yeah.
I forgot what it's called. I think they're going to have some there, maybe.
I mean, if this game's actually coming out in 2016, yeah, they got to keep showing stuff for the next 12 months. Yeah, that's to me, that's a crazy ambition based off where that game is now. I'm very happy they showed gameplay. I don't know. I don't know if it was the best idea to show it in this state.
I don't think that people are complaining about it. Yeah. Honestly, if people are complaining about it, it's probably just because they're not fans of the franchise and they expect to be wowed with everything they see. But I don't think I've even heard or seen a comment from a fan of the franchise being like, no, this looks like garbage. Because
it does look great.
It looks great. It reminded me of the gameplay we first saw of the new Zelda, right?
Oh, Matt, I thought of that immediately.
Yeah, yeah. It has the same kind of look and feel, and they paid a lot of attention to the animation of the grass, and it
beautiful.
Looks pretty damn gorgeous, especially for a game series that's never been like, we need full 4K resolution at 60 frames. They don't care about any of that
crap. Like cutting-edge tech or whatever.
It looks good without having to focus on all that junk.
That moment when the character steps over the hill and we reveal the waterfall, the thought in my mind in that moment was, oh, man, Zelda's not going to look this good. This is what Zelda should look like. Yeah. I shouldn't have thought that, but that was the thing that happened in my mind. Blood, do you like how it looks?
Oh, yeah. I especially like the animations of the enemies wandering around the map and all of that. But, yeah, it is kind of weird, though, because as you're saying, like, they didn't jump into a battle And yeah. I don't imagine that they're doing anything crazy different with how the battles look. So.
Oh yeah, we saw a screenshot along with an interview in the Jump magazine. It's basically, you see the back of the character and you see the front of the enemies. And then in the lower left-hand corner, there's just a traditional RPG menu.
Yeah,
pretty cool.
Importantly, 11 looks like it's capturing the feel of Dragon Quest a lot, which is super important. Especially, I'm sure you feel this way too.
Yeah, there's so much stress on that, right? Because when you make a huge graphical leap, like other games aren't afraid of making everything look more realistic, but that doesn't fit for Dragon Quest, right? We're not looking at a real world. We're not looking to pick up like a can of pop and be able to read it. Like that's not ever what it's been about. It always has a very unique look and feel, and they've captured that, and it still looks like a huge leap forward. So
we're excited, to say the least.
Yeah, it was cool. It was cool they had a whole event just for this game announcement.
Did they play any of the music? I really always liked the soundtrack to the
You're right.
Eight or whatever.
It has an excellent soundtrack. Yeah, they actually brought out the composer.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Throughout the whole thing, they were playing like some of the retro ones, and then they were playing like orchestral versions of some of the most iconic stuff. So they're like upgrading the same songs and keeping all the same sounds. It was really cool.
Yeah, Dragon Quest was one of the first series to actually have live concerts.
Oh, that's interesting. Good factoid. Let's move on. Let's talk about Red Ash.
Wow.
Red Ash was funded yesterday. I don't know how to... I don't even... How do we...
Here we go.
Okay, so...
Which one?
The whole... The prequel.
The prequel, not the anime?
The prologue.
And did they make enough to make the real game?
The real game is happening.
The real game is happening no matter... So, yeah, we'll just... That was fun. This was like an episode of TV show where, like, you just saw the heightening, and then it's just, like, 5 days earlier. And then we're like, okay, so we're leading up to that point. Let's talk about what Red Ash is. This is a new project from Keiji Inafune. This is a spiritual successor to Mega Man Legends. I mean, it just as like Mega Man Legends was Mega Man, this is Mighty No. 9. The characters Universe, Beck and Call are even in this. Yeah. This is a Kickstarter. Sure, like let's make this game. That Kickstarter launched on July 4th and didn't explode as we're used to seeing from most Kickstarters these days, most high profile Kickstarters, I should say. And I guess for a number of reasons, the video itself was kind of not exciting. I mean, it had like renders of what cutscenes would look like with like 2D elements, you know, and just nothing exciting to say about it, I would say. Did any of you watch it that first day?
Yeah.
Brad, what was your impression of this that first day?
I was like, they're already making a new game based off Mighty No. 9 that's not even out yet?
Yeah.
That's what I was... It like, I can understand why they're doing it, because like, he's probably...
He's done with
Mighty No. 9. Mighty No. 9 is like...
That's done.
Yeah, it's on the way out. He needs to do something else.
Yeah.
But just the fact they're doing like an animated series too, and they're doing something else with Mighty No. 9, like another animated series or movie or something like that.
It's got a live-action movie also in production.
Good God.
Yeah.
There's all these things planned out.
Yeah.
And I can't even play the first game yet.
You're right. Brad, I forgot that detail even. Here's another weird detail. Is when this Kickstarter launched on the 4th of July, there was also a Kickstarter concurrently with it for an anime based off of Red Ash.
I did not like that.
Yeah.
I did not like that.
So
is it a series or a short?
It was, depending on how much money it gets, it would either be a full-length, feature-length, or a 15-minute short. I think it's down to 6 minutes right now if they reach their initial goal. Just, oh, man. And that thing's not even close to getting where it needs to be. Okay, so that happened, and then that kind of fizzled.
Yep.
Did not get a ton of attention, did not get a ton of love. Everyone's kind of like, what is Inafune, what are you doing, man? He tried. On July 17th, the full game is offered as a reward. Okay, so it's now clearly revealed that the Kickstarter everyone was giving money to is an 8-hour prologue to a 12-hour full game, in their own words. So the Kickstarter is simply for the prologue. That's 4 chapters and 8 hours long.
Wait, that's so is the game crazy. 20 hours, or is the game 12 hours and you're getting 8 of the 12?
Not, there's no overlap. You are just getting a prologue.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's 8 hours.
It's a separate game. An 8-hour prologue.
Yeah.
It's and the ground zeros to the game.
Right.
Here's the good news, though. If you're willing to give $80 or more to the Kickstarter for the prologue, you get the full game for free.
No, you don't.
Well, that's not for free.
Yeah.
Pay $80.
That's just the cost of the bolt.
Yep.
Yeah.
But they're willing to promise already that that full game is happening. The prologue is in the is up in the air. It may or may not happen, but the full game is definitely happening, and you get that if you give us $80.
Is someone else paying for that, or are they going to do another Kickstarter for the full game later?
They said it's a sure thing. They said that full game is a sure thing.
Huh.
So the Kickstarter's funding just the prologue, or the Kickstarter's funding both, and then the reward was only for the prologue?
Kickstarter's funding only the prologue, as per Concept's declarations.
And we wonder why it failed.
It hasn't failed yet. Okay, so we're moving on. July 28th, a free prototype is released. Brad, you played this prototype.
No, I didn't.
You watched Ben play.
I watched Ben play.
Can you describe what it is?
It is a guy, or it's Beck, walking around in like an alley that's like not even 100 yards, like 50
Beck
yards.
Beck the musician?
Yes, Beck the musician is in it.
Oh, and weird.
This would be funded if Beck the musician was in it.
It's really rough. And you just walk around and you can kick a can and jump up some stuff.
It's bizarre. You're Beck from Mighty No. 9.
Love kicking the can, though.
You're the Mighty No. 9 character model at first, anyway. You can unlock...
They're secret hidden ones.
Yes. You can unlock the Red Ash character model.
Yeah. Why are you the Beck one?
Yeah.
Why?
Fair question.
Who's Beck, though, for real?
Oh, the main character of Mighty No. 9. He's Mega Man.
He's the new Mega
Man. But not one of these two.
Beck?
His name is Beck,
His name is Beck.
So he's not Mega Man.
Right.
He's the equivalent of Mega Man.
Okay.
Mighty No. 9 is Mega Man the series. Beck is Mega Man the character.
Right.
Yeah.
But in spiritual successorhood.
Right.
Correct.
Yes. Right. Yep.
And this is a spiritual successor of a different Mega Man?
Mega Man Legends.
Mega Man Legends, yes.
Okay. And that's the one you played as the red person with long hair?
Kind of. That was
Are you thinking of Zero?
No, he's thinking of Misadventures of Tron Bonn, I think.
I don't know.
I think he's thinking of Zero.
I'm thinking of Zero.
Oh, then no.
Sword?
Then absolutely not.
Zero. Mega Man Legends was more sword. Of an
RPG. Yeah, he's thinking of Zero.
Mega Man Legends is, an action RPG, action adventure. Oh my gosh. One of my favorite PS1 games. It's so good.
It's really cool.
I have a question.
Yep.
Did Mega Man Legends sell well?
Enough to get a sequel.
And the sequel bombed hard.
Sequel did bad.
Yep.
Sequel was still on PS1?
Yep.
Yes.
And it's not a
late PS1 era.
It's not a 2D side-scrolling platformer like Mega Man?
No, it's like Zelda. It's like Ocarina of Time, but almost better.
Weird.
Whoa.
No. I'm
whoa.
That's Kyle mode to the extreme. Yeah. I gotta reel it back a little bit. And then a day after that prototype is released, it has been announced that the Kickstarter has been fully funded by Fuse Entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
A company from China none of us have ever heard before, but apparently does a lot of things like this, but never anything on the scale.
Oh, no. Fuse is great.
Fuse. They make those drinks, right? They make those fruity drinks?
They make those games in China.
Oh, they got that cable channel. You know what? I love Fuse.
No, stop it.
If you Google Fuse Entertainment even, it's still really hard to find out this particular mm-hmm. Fuse. There's like five different Fuse Entertainments. Okay, and so the Kickstarter is still live. It's been funded by Fuse Entertainment, but what Concept has said is that, okay, all the money that we've raised so far is now stretch goals for we're still talking about this prequel.
But that's not how Kickstarter works.
No.
I don't think that's how Kickstarter works. I don't think you can do that.
Yeah, once the next 3 days are up and they don't have the money goes back to the people that gave them the money.
Yeah, but I mean, they could theoretically still get to $800,000. I think that's still in their minds.
Theoretically.
Yeah. I think they're still planning on saying, okay, now we're getting these stretch goals. Now give us money that we're already funded. Now that we're funded for sure, give us all your money. That was Ian.
What?
Got to check your phone.
What are you talking about?
No.
Oh, wasn't you?
That was
what
from
are you
somewhere
talking
else.
About?
That was from somewhere else? Outside of this room, or was it Brad?
I didn't hear it on the headphones.
Oh, whoa.
What even are you talking about?
Somebody got an email.
We get to watch Kyle have an extreme breakdown every episode of the show.
Kyle is out of his mind. So wait, is this thing funded or not?
Yes.
You guys are talking.
It's funded.
There's a publisher, but it's not on Kickstarter.
But not through Kickstarter. That's it's very confusing.
You have to have everybody promise to send us money through PayPal or something like that, because Kickstarter's not going to let those people give them money unless that goal is met.
Wait, I'm missing something. So some other company,
Fuse Entertainment,
is paying for the prologue
Yes.
under the table.
Yeah.
And then if they're funded in the actual sense of the word on Kickstarter, it's all just for the stretch
goals. It's all gravy, yep.
So yeah. They're not actually funded on Kickstarter.
Correct.
Right.
So the people don't want this.
I don't know. See, the thing is, if...
It's like every other week there's a new way where somebody's doing something really shady on Kickstarter, and it's like, is this shady? I can't tell.
It's shady. It's shady, shady for sure, because...
It's just confusing, if nothing else.
When, on July 4th, they say, we can't do this without your money. Now they're saying, hey,
we're just kidding.
We've done it, and now give us your money for other superfluous things.
But they're not taking our money because we're not giving them enough for them to actually do it through Kickstarter. But now the same thing's still going to happen without Kickstarter. But if the Kickstarter fails, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Also, shouldn't this be like fraud or something? Because you can't take someone's money for this, and then halfway through, after you've already had them promise you the money,
80%
say,
oh,
no,
of the way
it's
through,
not,
yeah.
It's so, not for that, it's for this.
How about
you
this?
You can't do that.
How about this?
Not right.
Would it still be as shady if this Fuse Entertainment put enough money into the Kickstarter as part of the deal to make it succeed?
I feel like that'd be shadier.
That'd be shadier. You can't you can't dump $800,000 into it.
But I mean, that's how Kickstarter works. Like, you get 60% of the way, and then like your rich dad or whoever gives you $1,000 of your own money, effectively.
Right.
To, you know, that's how. Like, that's how the low end.
A person could drop $800,000 if they wanted to. So why not an entity? Why not a business?
Because it's not what Kickstarter's for. Like Kickstarter
is just to make money. It doesn't matter where it's coming from.
Yeah, the Kickstarter, the company cares. Yeah, they don't want stuff like this going on. And
they're
going to
get paid regardless. I don't think they care.
They do. Because
everybody makes their money, and the product still happens, and the people still get their rewards. Why does it matter where the money comes from?
Because basically, when you're giving to a Kickstarter, you're donating. You're not buying a thing.
So the ticker here is that if somebody is going to put enough into a Kickstarter, and they also would reap profits from it. So let's say maybe like the details behind closed doors are they own a part of the property, or they own a piece of the kickback.
As Fuse Media does. They're an investor, not a donator.
Right.
Yeah.
So there's the key difference, right?
Has any Kickstarter ever done that where donators like you or I would have a stake? Like,
Kickstarter can't
end?
Do that. I think Project Cars might have on their other weirder
I mean, they did their own thing
or something.
Yeah. But Kickstarter doesn't do that for sure.
Okay,
you can't
get
any stake in the game from Kickstarter.
Yeah, so then they couldn't. If those are the rules, then Fuse couldn't donate.
Right,
and that might be
that's
why
in the bylaws.
Right, that's exactly why Fuse didn't give $800,000 through Kickstarter. Yeah, because they want the actual part of the game. They don't get any of the IP, but they obviously will get part of the profits. Mm-hmm.
So should they be hoping that the Kickstarter doesn't succeed? So that nobody pays a dime and the game still gets made, and then they just do it that way?
No, because they want little expansions to the story.
Isn't that going to draw... We're talking about it right now.
They get more stuff without having to pay for it.
Yeah.
They're probably all for it.
Yeah. They're all for it.
Still shady, though.
Oh, it's
still
so
shady. Still shady.
I think it won't succeed. I don't think it'll get to $100,000, but I think the right thing to do is when you get funded, you say, okay, we got funded. We're good. Thank you.
Here's
we're shutting
money.
Down the Kickstarter.
Yeah, how much do they back. Have right yeah. now? How much money?
So they have about, I think it was like 477. They have less than 500,000 of 800,000.
So they're like a little over halfway.
And here's the, I mean, we're gonna wrap this up, but here's the funniest thing about this. When they announced yesterday that it was completely funded, the Kickstarter campaign is going 100% towards more content. Consider your pledge a contribution to stretch goals from here on out. Exactly what are those stretch goals? We're sorry to say that we will have to wait a little longer.
Oh,
like you said, we're very busy with many behind the scenes things over here, and we apologize if you feel left in the dark.
That's the worst statement.
That is so bad.
These people are morons.
Yeah, if you've given them any bit of money, but let's say people have given them thousands. If you've given them thousands, you have no idea right now what your thousands are going to.
Oh my God.
You can back out, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. At any time.
You're never...
So everyone funny. Take your money out of this.
You probably
These people
should.
People are insane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it should be noted you're not charged until the last day.
Exactly, yeah. So nobody's
right.
paid a dime
right.
yet. And
no,
even
obviously.
If they do, like, you... That's the weird thing, right? Sorry, I'll be really quick.
Yeah.
You put as much money in as you felt like you'd get... enough back out of it. Like, if you feel like you're going to get enough for $1,000, you want the $1,000 reward, and you're like, yes, I'll pay $1,000 to get that, and then also help this thing happen. They're still going to get that if it succeeds. So technically, in a way, everybody who's funded the Kickstarter will get exactly what they paid for, like what they expected to pay for. It's just, where's the money going after that fact?
Yeah, yeah. And honestly, I think it's about the feeling, Matt, is just like, oh, I'm helping this game happen, as opposed to, ooh, I'm helping this DLC become reality.
And I get that.
Yeah,
I get that.
I think that's honestly, it's a different mentality, and that's why mm-hmm. I think it's right.
But it's also just, it's just dirtbag practices, because it's like, Kickstarter didn't used to work like this. Stretch goals were like, we crushed it. This is awesome. Now we can do all the things that we never thought we'd like.
Yeah.
Our pie in the sky, you know, crazy right. dreams. Now we can do those. Now Kickstarter is just like, we're asking for 800,000, but this thing really costs, you know, 3 million. So if we get 3 million, then the real thing comes out. Yeah. But 800,000 is just like, whatever.
Do you think we'll see more high profile Kickstarters this
yes.
year?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Yes.
Wow, everyone's so positive about that.
Yeah, I mean, the scale keeps going up. Technically, yeah. if an indie developer makes a Kickstarter, they've funded their own time and money, like they're putting their own resources into it to try to make it happen, or at least maybe they've got a demo, maybe they're halfway through developing it, but they need Kickstarter to finish, something like that. The scale just keeps getting bigger. It's like Shenmue. You know, I made 6.6 million or whatever, but it actually costs 20 million to make or whatever. Obviously, Yu Suzuki's helping fund it, and then, you know, he'll get some other investors in there too. At the end of the day, like I said, everybody who decided to pay is going to get exactly what they put in for.
They're going to get more than what they put in for, probably.
Every single Kickstarter in some way is going to be also funded by somebody else, like by the people who are making it. They'll put their own personal resources into it, or another company, what have you. I don't think we should be surprised at that. It's just the scale is going to keep going up. You're going to get somebody who needs that extra $5 million on their $20 million project or something like that. That's the same thing as somebody who needs $5,000 when they've already put $1,000 into an indie film or something.
Yeah, and I mean, we've talked about it earlier about how like it's working as basically an advertising campaign. You know what I mean? It's mm-hmm. to get people excited about it. I think that this failed in those regards.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, yeah, this whole thing, it just reeks of just being just very poor communication and mm-hmm. multiple levels, because like, in a way, I mean, you're giving to a Kickstarter. The whole point is that you want to see this game get made. And so, like, theoretically, like, you should be happy. That's like, oh, somebody, you know, saw what we're doing and they decided to just front the money. And yeah, it's a for sure thing. This game's happening now. I'll get to play this game. But just the whole, the feel of it is mm-hmm. just weird. It's just wrong for some reason. And it's like, And other, you know, and this happens with other games where they get, you know, publishers to help out and to make this stuff happen. But for some reason, just like everything about this Kickstarter has felt off.
If an investor shows up and offers money to say, like, I'm ecstatic that Sony said, oh, yeah, we'll help with Shenmue. And I'm like, whatever it takes, just do it. People who want these games, should it matter? Like, if they simply communicated better, would it solve all of this? Like, they obviously panicked because somebody contacted them and said, here's all the money to make that game. The only way they actually attracted that investor is probably through the publicity of the Kickstarter. Or, like,
but it was not good publicity.
No, definitely not. But let's say like they tried for years to get an investor on the game or something like that, and then they do Kickstarter and it's kind of fledgling, or maybe it just barely makes it, and somebody's like, you know what, I want to fund your entire game. Let's talk about a deal. Should they not be able to do that just because it's on Kickstarter?
They should not. No, they should.
And also, like, timetable-wise, I don't know if that's realistic. That within the span of 20 whatever days, that an investor would materialize and that it would be sure enough deal, a sure enough deal that they would announce it. Like, that doesn't happen in 20 days typically.
So you think this was in the works?
I think it was in the works. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a bad time to announce it. Mm-hmm. It is rotten business all around. I have no sympathy for anything about this Kickstarter project.
I'm excited for the game, but that Kickstarter shenanigans.
Yeah, Red Ash the game,
I'm like,
might
yes,
still be cool.
I want to play. I'm kind of like, yeah, but it's a little not so good what you did right there. Though.
Not so good what you did so good. Right there. Let's move on to next week's news. Gamescom is next week, and we have a lot of things that are announced for Gamescom mm-hmm. next week already. Here's the thing. The new World of Warcraft expansion is going to debut at Gamescom.
Crazy.
August 6th, 9 a.m. PT. Brad, why is this crazy?
This is like so fast. The last expansion came out
last year.
Yeah. It hasn't even been a year. There was usually like a year and a half or 2 year gap period between mm-hmm. them, I think.
World of Warcraft expansions are events.
Yeah.
They're huge deals.
I wonder if they're doing this for, like, they're kind of hemorrhaging subscribers. Mm-hmm. They have been for a long time.
Yeah.
Because when a new expansion comes out, everyone comes back and plays. And I think if they can make more money, pretty much, like, more expansion, you can pay $60. I'll buy it. I'm a sucker. I'll buy it.
Did you play Draenor?
Yeah, I've played them all.
Okay. So what would you like to see from this? What do you want to see announced for World of Warcraft? What can help World of Warcraft? What is left to explore?
Well, for me, I only play technically half the game because I only do PvP stuff when I play that game. So, like, the whole raiding aspect, PvE, I'm very ignorant about.
Wait, that's the best part, though.
I know, but a lot of people like the PvE aspect.
So, really, you only play World of Warcraft against other people?
Yes.
That's crazy. I didn't know there were people like that.
Yeah. That's, okay, like, the only way I play that game. Just more updates. Like, there's seasons in the game.
I'm sorry, Brad. The way you get experience points is just killing other people?
No, no, no. I mean, you level up going through the game. But okay, when I'm level cap, I purely do PvP.
Oh, okay, got it.
But, there wasn't enough updates when I was playing. Like, in between arena seasons, it was, like, 8 months, 6 months. Some ridiculously long, huge gap. So I'd just get all my stuff and just have nothing to do for a long time. So I would just quit.
So you want them to put in, like, seasons for PvP. You want it to become esports.
Well, they have that already. But, like, more frequent is what,
okay,
I'm saying.
Sure.
Like, in Draenor, it took way too long. I was already done by that time. I was out.
Like, what's going to make... What are they going to show in this trailer that's on August 6th? That's going to make you go, like...
I don't know, dude. Something from Warcraft 3. I'll be like, oh, some sort of guy from it. I don't even know.
Is it all it takes? Is that, like... Because I don't know how World of Warcraft, honestly, can drum up excitement this year. Do you know what I mean? At Gamescom.
Literally, with drums.
Yes. We're going to have drums, you think? I bet there will be drums. Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, that booth would be huge.
Quick question.
Okay.
Do you think that, I mean, there's an obvious tie-in, and that's the movie. I have a feeling like they probably want to kick out this thing in time for people to play something to set up the movie.
Matt
makes
Blair,
sense.
I totally forgot about that.
Amazing sense.
What I would much rather have, or at least have in addition, is set up Warcraft 4.
Oh my God, I knew you were going to say that.
All right, now we're dreaming. We're officially in the dream zone.
I wish.
If that's what it takes to move us on.
Okay, well, then also another crazy announcement happened. 2K is set to reveal Mafia 3 on August 5th at 5 a.m. PT.
Cool.
What a weird way to announce that. It certainly leaked a bunch of times, Mafia 3. I think we kind of knew it was happening. But that game has not been officially spoken yet. And now it's just like, oh yeah, we're going to show you a trailer.
This has been a good week for Michael Huber.
Right?
Yeah.
Right. Mafia, one of Huber's favorites.
When did Mafia 2 come out?
A while ago.
Ooh, yeah.
A long time ago.
2009, 2010?
Ian, can we get a check on that?
I don't know.
Mafia 2 release.
Like 5, 6 years?
Yeah, a long time ago. It's kind of like it's almost like a Max Payne gap, where it's just like, oh, do people still care about this? Do people still care about Mafia?
I think Huber does.
Yeah, Huber does.
I think people could easily be made to care about it.
Yeah, I think it has a loyal fan base.
They're following kind of the... they didn't start it, but the success with the Fallout 4 announcement was because they said a week ahead of time, we're going to announce it, we're going to have our own stream, and we're going to do it right here at this time.
Yeah,
and
Mafia 3 is getting
so many people are going to follow suit with that because it was so successful. And, like, they're in the middle of nowhere, right? Like, they're going to do that.
Well, I mean, they're doing it at Gamescom. It's August 5th.
August 23rd, 2010.
But it's, like, day zero, right?
So it's been 5 years. Yeah. We'll get to it, but Xbox will precede this.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it. So it's in the middle of, like, all the press.
It's in the middle of Gamescom, yeah. Cool. It's not like they have the whole week to themselves with Mafia 3, but yeah, they're willing to put it up against these other games, these other press conferences.
Yeah, no, if they wanted to do it, they're doing the right thing, I think.
Rumor is it takes place in Louisiana, which I think could be really exciting.
Really cool.
Hmm. Yeah, I do in like the that. 70s. Louisiana in the 70s. Hmm. Yeah. And you're gangsters, you're just like some...
Sounds cool.
You say that's the rumor, or they've said something?
That's the rumor. All we've seen so far is one image of four characters, one being a woman with an afro. So I guess you could assume it's at least 70s, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm pumped.
Yeah, sounds good.
I'm really, really pumped. Okay, the EA press event is on August 5th at 1 a.m. Pacific time. This is funny. I kind of just did this in order of things I'm excited about as opposed to things that are chronologically in order.
Mafia was number one for you?
I'll do the chronological order. No, the Xbox press event I'm most excited about. So let's talk about EA, though.
Okay.
They're at Gamescom. Why EA? Why Gamescom?
What do you mean? They're at Gamescom. They have a press conference every year.
Yeah, why?
They have a ton of games.
What do you mean?
I think you have to justify
it now. The Battlefront there?
Yeah.
They got FIFA there? What do you mean?
Well, what do they have new to show? Why are they doing a press event? They have an hour-long press
event. Maybe they'll show more Mass Effect or
something.
Yeah,
I mean, they usually have new stuff to show off at Gamescom.
I wonder if we'll see the two other new IPs that were announced in the E3 press event for EA. They said, hey, we're working on three new IPs. Here's one. And it was Entwined? No, Entwined's a whole different game.
Oh, Unravel?
Unravel, yeah. Yeah.
When is D23?
D23 is late August.
Late August.
Yep.
Okay.
Oh, they have Mirror's Edge, though, too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They can show that.
What? Yeah, and that's supposedly coming out fairly soon. So that's probably a good chance of it being there.
That'd be fair, because people were playing a demo of Mirror's Edge at E3. I never played that demo. I wonder how that was. So
Huber got to play it.
Maybe we'll see some actual like live gameplay of that. That would be cool.
It depends on what they like, what they really want to focus on. But sports are bigger, I would say.
Oh
in
yeah,
Europe
FIFA
than they
will
are
out
here.
There.
Yeah, so, FIFA will have a good chunk of that time.
You think they'll give Pele more time?
if they could get him again. He was very happy with his last appearance. He seemed very jolly.
Yeah. It's funny reading the stuff afterward. Like, apparently, like, he was, he had a lot of things, because they had rehearsal, and he was very mean to American football.
Mm-hmm.
Like, very critical of it. It was, like, opposed to, like, how beautiful the other world's football is. And he's just like, yeah, American football is just, like, gross and stupid. And they're like, Pele, you know what?
We so mad at him. Please, don't do that.
That's so funny to me. Oh, man, they let him talk for so long. Yeah, they'll probably talk about FIFA and its, what is it called? It's Ultimate Something Mode. Ultimate Team Mode.
Ultimate
I don't know.
Team. Yeah.
Yeah, they'll probably do a lot of that stuff. I'm excited to watch it. I'm excited to see what EA brings to Gamescom.
Yeah, I think for sure that and Mirror's Edge, and they'll probably show something new for Battlefront. They'll probably have a big...
Oh, the co-op mode. They're probably going to show off that co-op mode.
Yeah, they'll have a big group of people out there like they tend to do with Battlefield. They bring a lot of guys on stage and do a live multiplayer. So they'll probably do that. I think the timing of it is definitely interesting, because in the past, EA... it was always EA and Sony that were kind of Tuesday afternoon, evening... and then Gamescom would have the press day on Wednesday. And then this year, they're doing right before the show floor opens. Maybe even during the show floor opens. So,
yeah, weird.
Yeah.
Wait, on press day? Or,
press
or
day, yeah.
Public day? Oh, on press day. Yeah, that makes no sense. That's very frustrating for press people, huh? And but
not
also,
entirely, because it's probably planned out, so the doors, you know... May not. I mean, there may not be a whole lot going on during that time.
I also feel that press events are becoming less and less about the press.
Yeah, they are their own press.
They're now about like the 100,000 people who are watching online, more than ever, I would say.
Oh, the press conference itself. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And so, yeah, I think it's more for all of us than it is for the people with laptops in the room now, which is pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I love that, to be honest. And then, yes, finally, the Xbox press event will be on August 4th. Finally, but actually first in chronological order. I'm so sorry I did it this way. That'll be at 7 a.m. Pacific time. That's going to be huge.
Yeah.
Scale bound.
Quantum break. Yeah.
Quantum break. And the third one is the game where you jump around buildings a bunch.
Crackdown.
Crackdown. Thank you. Crackdown 3, or it doesn't have a 3 on it yet. It's still called Crackdown.
So that's like 4 in the afternoon, so that's when EA usually goes. So maybe Microsoft just bumped EA, and they're like, when do we do it now?
Yeah, I wonder if Microsoft can just bump EA. That's pretty crazy. Yeah, so that is Crackdown is going to have gameplay. Mm-hmm. Scalebound is most likely going to have gameplay that we'll see for the first
time. Yeah.
And Quantum Break is probably going to be, hopefully, in a near-finished state.
Yeah, hopefully release date.
What are you excited about here?
Scalebound, yeah.
Very much.
Very curious to see Scalebound, and kind of also very curious if they talk about Windows 10.
They will talk a lot about Windows 10.
Don't even be curious. Yeah.
They will talk a lot about Halo.
Right? But like, there's been some weirdness around that, and it like literally just launched as we're talking about this. Mm-hmm. It's like still rolling out to people and whatnot, but there's supposed to be a whole lot of functionality, especially with gaming. And like, things that were thought to be Xbox One exclusive either also coming out on PC, or they're just, you're going to be able to stream it like remote play, basically, which, why would you ever do that? But
wait, you stream remote play all the time
on the, like, on the Vita and whatnot. Like, I don't sit down and play games on my Vita across the internet just because I can.
Yeah, but I guess I get what you're saying. Maybe it saves you the cost of like one extra long HDMI cable, basically.
Sure.
Is really what that does in a living room, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Maybe across the house.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Just PC gamers, like they have a PC, they're going to play on their PC.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
They're not going to remote into their Xbox, even especially if it's in the same house, and try to play like in their.
Oh man,
you're gonna fall asleep the moment they mention Windows 10.
I will only be curious to hear them talk about, because it's a very, they're dancing on a fine line with all that stuff. Whether they like they released their quote unquote exclusives on a PC as well, or if it's just remote play. If they release the stuff on PC, they're hurting their console sales, but they're also thinking like people are just going to keep buying PCs, so maybe we'll take credit for that too.
I mean, with the Windows 10 integration, you can also like get in a chat room with people on PC and on Xbox One. That's a cool thing.
Sure. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that there aren't cool things about it. It's just the overall strategy of it. I'm very curious to see why and what they're going to do going forward with it, or if they're just going to drop it entirely, like just so that they could sell Xboxes like early on by saying it's exclusively on these things, and then just forget about it, kind of like.
What was when they had Xbox Live on PC? What was that called? Windows.
Oh, Windows Live
for Windows.
Yeah,
Live.
I hope it doesn't end up like that.
Where everyone has to patch it out.
That was not good.
Yeah.
They honestly haven't done much different from when they were talking about games for Windows Live. You know what I mean? I just think that Windows 10 might work out because Windows 10 is better, is my hope.
It's possible. And it was integrated from the ground up when they started developing and all that junk. It's fine.
It might work out. Okay. let me go in chronological order. So here's what we had to look forward to. If you're a person who's crazy about streaming all these things, like I am, August 4th, 7 a.m. Pacific time is the Xbox press event, kicking it off. Then August 5th, at 1 a.m. Pacific time, you got that EA press event. Then, the other two are just trailers, so you don't have to like stay awake for these, really. But then Mafia 3 is going to do its reveal on August 5th, that same day at 5 a.m. And then the next day, August 6th, 9 a.m., is when we see that World of Warcraft expansion.
All times Pacific.
Mm-hmm. All times Pacific. Specifically Pacific. What's wrong, Ian?
What?
What's wrong, man?
What are you talking about?
That expression you made. What was running through your mind at that moment?
That's just Ian's face.
Kyle, we can't make cuts on this
water.
Show.
God damn it, Bossman. Why do you do these things?
These are my favorite parts of the
show.
You're
hearing weird sounds. You're seeing faces. I mean, my eye feels like it has dust in it. Maybe you saw
that was
like,
it, man. You got dust in your eyes?
Dusty eye?
Yeah, my friend and I, it was hot the other day, so I put on the air conditioner in our living room, which I haven't turned on in a long time, and I was like leaning over to do it.
Uh-huh.
And it just like blasted me right in the face with all this air conditioner dust.
And you still have it in your eyes.
I don't know if I do. I think it might be like psychosomatic, but like, my eyes, it's dry now. I don't know.
Give him some of that Clear Eyes. You got some.
Yeah.
I've been doing the drops, but I ran out of drops. I need Ben Stein to come and save me.
Kyle's your boy.
He don't do that no more.
Yeah, he doesn't. I was thinking about Ben Stein the other day.
Kyle got that reference.
Ben Stein?
Yeah,
I watch commercials.
It was on TV.
Yeah, I watch commercials.
Bossman is an uncultured swine.
Let's move on to, well, you're the one who started this conversation. We're going to have to kind of breeze through this one, but this is a good comment. This is from Mackie Sean. I feel like first impression counts for a lot in video games, so my question for the panel is this. Would you rather play a beta and test an unfinished product, or would you rather wait until the full finished game is released? I find that, like how Kyle is for Metal Gear Solid 5, for the games I'm most excited about, I don't want to play a second of the game until it comes out. I avoided the demo of Final Fantasy XV when I play that game. I want to play it in its entirety without stopping in its finished state. When a new game comes out, I love for it to feel fresh and new, and I think a beta can detract from that. However, I do understand that for monetary reasons, it would be smarter to test a game out first to see if you enjoy it enough to purchase. The panel's thoughts, please, for Mackie Sean. It's kind of like what we're talking about with Dragon Quest. Is like, do you want to see a game in a janky state or an uncompleted state?
It's a case-by-case basis for me.
So what's the cases?
Like, I did play Final Fantasy 15.
Why?
I feel like, I don't know. Because, like, I've been seeing that game for, like, how many years? It's been 6, 8 years. I don't know.
Yeah, it's been
a lot of
years.
I could finally play this. Like, it's real. I was like, yeah, I'll play it for a little bit. I didn't finish the demo, but I just played it for a little bit. I don't have to finish them. But like Dark Souls 2, I'd played that when I could.
What does that mean when you could play it when you could?
Well, like with the beta timers are open for you to play it.
Hopped
I played
that.
That
beta. Ooh, baby.
So wait, did that beta ruin the game for you of Dark Souls 2?
Nope. Not a bit.
Why not?
It was awesome. I mean, we kicked ass through that area again. because you knew where everything
was.
Yeah,
playing Dark Souls again for me is like,
it doesn't really
no problem.
It's kind of part
I'm
of the game.
It. Yeah, I'm like, yes, I will do this again. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And so then when do you, what's the other side, Brad? When do you say, no, I'm not going to try this beta?
Just for like a game sometimes if I'm just like, I'm like, yeah, I'm excited for that game, but not like really, really excited for it sometimes. Like, if there was like a, if there was like a Witcher beta or something like that.
You would say, no, I'll hold out.
Yeah, I'm like, I'll just wait.
Okay.
Or like, if they did Metal Gear Solid 5, I would just be like, I'm waiting.
So what's really funny, Brad, is there's like, there's like, if you're way, way too excited, you're playing that beta.
Sometimes I can't.
If you're
control
pretty
myself,
excited,
right.
You're not playing that beta.
Correct.
And if you're not excited at all, you're not playing that beta because you don't care about
correct.
It.
Correct.
So there's like this weird, like, dip.
It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
But it's all just feeling it in the moment.
That's a, that's the truth, though. I think it is a feeling in the moment. Where do you stand, Blood?
Yeah, I'm also definitely case by case. But I think, yeah, with 15, I would want to try that out just because, you know, the mechanics and. And I'm just curious about that, and I don't feel like, for whatever reason, I don't feel like I'm spoiling anything of that world. I'm not that invested in it yet. And something else where like I, like a Zelda or something, where like I just or a Metroid game, like I would want to get into that and for it to be as perfect as possible for the first time.
Absolutely, yeah.
Metal Gear, I probably. You know, would want to not do a early demo of that or anything.
But like Tembo the Badass Elephant, you're just like, yeah, I don't care what I'm watching here.
Yeah, I just want to check it out. Yeah.
Because like I even go so far, Matt Blair, tell me if this is crazy. I go so far as to not watch reviews for games that I intend to play.
Not crazy.
Yeah, that's not crazy at all.
Where do you stand?
The whole thing kind of feels like for me, people forget the fact that you have a choice. Always have a choice. Like, people don't get mad at movie trailers for coming out. You want to see it.
I get mad at those.
But you have the choice to not watch it, and you make that choice. You don't get mad that they exist.
You're right.
This is, exact same thing, but for the games industry. It's like, I know we have trailers in games, and you can just kind of see it, but, like, the primary experience for watching a movie is just watching it. So when you watch the trailer and then you watch the movie, you're watching a part of it. Same experience, right? So, in theory, for a video game, when you play the game, if you get to play a little bit of it, that's kind of the trailer to a game. You get to play it. Whether it's a beta or a demo, it doesn't really matter. The concept's still the same. Now, the conversation's a little bit different for beta to demo, because a beta is ideally supposed to be out there so that they can test, mm-hmm. so that they don't have launch day problems, because when you spend $60 and then, you know, their servers drop because it's overloaded or they had some terrible glitches that they couldn't really anticipate, developing a game is hard. You want to avoid that whatever cost. So doing a beta makes sense.
Yeah.
Having
a
demo,
don't always consider a beta a demo. Don't always do that.
Oh, yes. No, yeah, don't do that.
But having a demo out, especially on launch day for a big game that maybe you like, it's for an RPG and you never played an RPG before,
nah,
but you like the
anymore.
Art style. I know, but we should, because a demo used to be a really big selling point for a game. Like, I played this demo, now click here to buy this. Like, you'd expect that to be a lot more prevalent these days when everything's online all the time and
right.
when everything's connected and all that stuff.
Or some games, I mean, what some games have done is the, you get to play for like a couple of hours, and then, you know, if you want to play the whole game, then
demos,
you purchase it.
Ian, do you have your mic on?
No.
Okay.
You're a psycho. Oh,
I'm definitely a psycho today.
What is going
on? You have derailed the conversation.
Oh my god.
Well, I'm just hearing this whirring this whole time.
That's fine.
All right.
It's okay.
No,
let
people listen to
this
podcast.
That's what it sounds like when my mic is on.
Okay. So I just hear that to a lesser extent.
Destiny.
Yeah.
What about Destiny?
Like,
great beta,
Destiny
right?
Alpha and beta.
Destiny's a thing, because I played the alpha, and I was like, whoa. Because I thought I had written Destiny off. I was like, it's on the old-gen consoles. It's going to be trash.
Yeah.
And then I played the alpha, and I was like, whoa, this game's cool. I could get into this. And then I played the beta, and I was like, oh, I'm over this now. And then I played the real game, and I was like, I'm still over this.
No, you played through that whole game.
No, I did, but I was over it. Like,
yeah.
The whole time.
No, you weren't.
Weird.
No, there were parts of the game you enjoy, I feel like.
There are a few parts of that I enjoy. Like, my friends is fun, but, like,
yeah.
Like, that's an example of a time where an alpha got me into the game, a beta got me un-into the game.
Yeah, but here's the thing. That like, Destiny was one of those ones where their alpha and beta, like, they were just the beginning of the game, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's the worst thing to do to me.
What do you mean?
Because it just, like, when you sit down and you play the game, then you're bored because, like, well, okay, I already know how it all starts.
You basically summed up the game after a little while, yeah.
You know, but I mean, but I think it goes for most games. Like, you don't really want the very beginning of it. You want some, like, random slice.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
You know, that...
I had that experience playing King's Quest last night, whereas, because I had seen a demo of the game at E3 that was the first... you know, whatever, a couple of parts, 20, 30 minutes. And I was kind of just like going through it because I've seen it so many times just to get past
and
it.
And you don't want that. You don't
and
want
then
that
I
feeling.
I want to actually play the game. Yeah. So in that case, a beta is not cool.
Some
so
games, it doesn't matter though. Like MGS2.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
You're like, oh, demo, I'll play this again.
Yeah, but the demo was like way cooler than the actual tanker because you can torture guys.
Oh, look out. Yeah. So MGS2 is such a good example, Brad, because that was designed to be a demo. It was designed to be misleading. It was so much self-awareness was put in that demo.
Sell it.
Yeah. Best case scenario. So to Mackie Sean, I would basically say, I think, that definitely we're cool with you not playing games demos if you don't want to play
them.
Yeah. Don't play betas if you don't want to play them. But I think they do. They exist for a good reason. Betas especially, and so like
feedback.
Yeah, and so yeah.
Like
you know,
episode Duske or whatever you say it, changing stuff in the game.
Yeah,
making it better.
Oh my gosh, that's unprecedented. I'm still so proud of them for that. They updated a demo. they patched a demo.
Yeah.
Added sign of good faith.
Yeah, that's so cool. I'm really, really pumped for that game. All right, so thank you, Mackie Sean, for your comment. It is definitely time for bets, though. So let's talk about this week's bet. Rare Replay is going to release on Tuesday. If you haven't heard, it's Rare's 30th anniversary. They got 30 games in that box for $30.
That's a pretty sweet deal, actually.
That is a ridiculous deal.
Every time
every time I look at that list of games, I'm just like, how?
Yeah.
Getting this
game
for
$1. It seems like they're losing money. It seems like somebody's losing money there. Basically, because of that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the 10 most recent reviews on GameRankings.com.
Mm-hmm.
How many times will I see the word value?
Do you want me to start?
No, I don't think I do, Brad. I think it's actually it's my turn to start. I got to go first. Okay. I think that we will see the word value 7 times.
Ooh.
I stole Brandon's bet, basically. In Brandon's absence, I've taken his number.
Take that, Brandon.
All right, Brad, how many times do you think we will see the word value?
12.
12 times?
Ooh. 12 times, maybe.
You think somebody's saying value more than once in their review?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Value tone.
Value, value, value. Bloodworth?
I think people try to actively avoid the word a little bit.
Ooh,
use
nice.
Other words.
So what's your bet?
5.
Nice.
I don't have anywhere near as much faith as Bloodworth. Going with 13.
Big 13.
13.
Matt Blair for Brandon Jones shuts out the super seat. All right, let me lock those in. Okay, we did those live now. Let's talk about last week's bet. As Ian just said, King's Quest released earlier this week. How many letters will there be in the name of the first item we can put into our inventory? Jones bet 8. I bet 5. Elise in the super seat bet 8. Blood bet 6. The item you put in your inventory first is a wooden handle.
Yeah, and this was interesting because we had a couple of different things that went back and forth to where I thought I had won at one point.
Yeah.
I think Elise messaged Nicole. And she said it was like a hatchet.
Yeah. Hatchet you get way later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's that, but the thing is like we were talking about how is it worded in the description.
Yeah.
And actually the hatchet is like a hatchet and then parentheses for using responsibly. So it would have been way more.
Actually, all the items you put in your inventory are kind of long, actually.
Most of them, yeah.
Yeah.
But for this one, like Elise just said, the first thing's handle. So I just thought it was handle.
Yeah, Blood was celebrating.
Which would have been 6.
Yep.
But then when I got to it, I was like, no, it's a wooden handle. Yeah.
So here's what happens. Those two people bet 8 win the bet. I told Brandon Jones about this last night, and I said, you can use your Thunderbolt right now. You can kill the Super Seat winning a point. And he said, no, I'm not going to use my Thunderbolt
yet. Why did you do that?
I think he wants to use it spitefully against me or Blood. I don't think he wants to use it against the Super Seat.
So wait, do both get a point now?
They both get a point, but they have to do the tiebreaker game to see who gets to promote a video and who gets to sign us off.
Nice.
Yeah.
I don't really even care about doing that.
Brad,
just let Matt do it.
That's not an option. That's not an option to not care. That's not an option to not care. So here's how this works. Blood will pick a category. We use cities, for example. And so somebody would be like, oh, Santa Fe, New York City, Santa Monica. And so, you know, it's like back and forth. So Blood's going to pick a category. Judge Ian, will determine if somebody's been stumbling for too long.
Sure thing.
Oh, okay. So just keep saying things.
I have a buzzer. Yeah. Do I have a buzzer?
I doubt you got a buzzer.
I thought I did.
So while Ian searches for a buzzer, Bloodworth, please come up with a category for these two to compete in.
Aha, I have a buzzer.
Oh, you do? Cool.
Okay. And so
you're gonna get buzzed.
So Brad, since you're in the super seat, you will actually go first since you're points leader.
Okay.
And then so you will go first, and Blair, you will go second. All right. So Ian's ready.
I'm ready.
All right. So Brad, as soon as Blood comes up with a category, you got to go. Okay.
Okay.
All right, Blood. What is our category?
Sitcoms.
Seinfeld.
Friends.
That Brad! Dang
no,
it, Brad.
I didn't care. I just wanted to move along.
No.
He threw it.
You don't.
He threw it.
He wishes he threw it.
It's part of the game.
No,
baby.
No. I saw you lock up, Brad. You locked up.
You froze up out there,
you
Brad.
Froze up. I would have too, dude. This game is so hard on my brain. So Matt Blair, you may choose whether you want to promote a video or whether you want to close out the show with your.
Wait, I thought he gets both.
Phrase. You don't get both. No, you.
Oh, can't.
You
I used make, to get both.
Yeah, I used to get both.
What if you give me the choice to do with the second thing?
What?
I can either choose to do both, or I do one, and then he has to do the other.
Yeah,
that makes more sense.
Which one do you want to do?
I'll pick a video.
Okay, so and then Brad will close us out.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so what video do you want to promote?
I don't know.
Why would you pick that?
Well, then why did you?
You don't know what video you want to promote?
I froze up. I'm sorry,
Matt. When did we film?
What'd you film?
What did we film together on the couch?
You should plug an episode of a sitcom.
That you're super passionate about.
That we talked about today.
A video
but
that
you can never get
watch.
Enough of.
I wish that we had a trailer because I would want to talk about that. But we did have a nice little 30-minute reaction stream to Dragon Quest XI. And that is live and in full HD on YouTube, on our YouTube channel. It's on our reviews channel, I believe, right?
GT mm-hmm. Reviews.
So youtube.com/GT-reviews.
No, just GT Reviews.
Just GT Reviews, all one word? Okay, cool. Go there. You should be able to find it pretty promptly in the videos tab. It is the Dragon Quest XI announcement reactions. Check it out. We showed all of the video footage that we could in the background there as well, so you should be able to catch a look at everything we talked about today. On to you, Brad.
Okay, so I'm going to close this out.
Yeah, but also you got to do like thank yous and
yeah, thank
and
you
that.
For watching, everybody.
Yep.
I want to thank you guys for letting me be here again.
Oh, Brad.
It's always a pleasure.
It's a pleasure to have you here.
So you should follow us on Twitter. I am at BradleyElsa87. We got D Bloodworth 2, right?
Yep.
Mattias.
14.
And Kyle Barsman.
And what about that guy?
And it's just Ian Hink, right?
Yeah.
At Ian Hink?
Yeah.
We're getting there. Let him catch up.
Oh, he's doing the lower thirds yep. to people who are just listening.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Just cutting them off early, the lowers.
I feel like...
No big deal.
I don't know if we have to do that. Should we just...
I don't know. Should we just not put them up again?
Yeah,
They're in the beginning.
And I don't think we have to announce our Twitter handles. You know what I mean?
Okay. I don't know.
Just put them up as one...
I feel like from here out...
That's what we do usually.
Like, if you win the bet, you
but
do your Twitter handle.
It and it's a pain.
Oh, okay.
I feel like we should do that from here out. What okay. do you think about that?
Only the winner gets
only
a
the
Twitter
winner
handle?
Gets a Twitter handle.
Eh.
That seems weird.
All maybe or nothing. They can say it, okay. but he puts up.
No more fifth measures.
Let us know if you like that part where we say what our Twitter handles are.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, let us know if you like that part or if you want
to
kill it.
And so, let us know how you feel about Kyle derailing everybody today.
Yeah.
I'm just
thing.
Trying to make the best show possible.
I'm going
to
give a little context.
Kyle, micromanagitis.
Wait. Kyle, wait, what was that face you just made?
It
are you
was,
all right?
It was
Kyle,
a,
are you okay?
The face, the expression I was trying to make is one of support. I just want to let you all know that I'm here for you. Just want, I'm the audience, I'm here for you. Just trying to make the best show possible.
But are you okay, though?
I'm a little not okay.
You look a little
what's wrong. Okay. What's wrong, Kyle?
Not enough Red Bull. I need to finish this can.
Red
Brad,
Bull's bad for you.
It's good for you. A
little
you
context.
Nah.
So my sign out,
yeah.
as a boy who grew up in Southern California,
yeah.
big movie for us. Was Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Was it really?
Oh, yeah. Growing up here, that's like our life.
So it wasn't a joke. It was like, that movie's
no,
pretty good.
No, San Dimas. Like, that's real deal.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's one line in that movie that always stuck with me that they say, be excellent to each other. And I'll never forget it. So be excellent to each other, everybody out there.
It's a great sign off, Brad.
I love...
What's that?